This is Max Martin. If you don't know who he is, you're not alone, but you should, and here's why. Because currently he holds the number 3 spot for the most number 1 hit songs ever. The only number 1 and 2 spots who with more holding of number 1 songs are John Lennon and Paul McCartney of the Beatles. And the Beatles had 20 by themselves, and then both McCartney and Lennon had some number 1 hits after that. Currently, Max Martin is sitting at 23 at the time of recording this video. I am sure with his career and the pace that he's still working on projects, he will exceed both Lennon and McCartney with, you know, just a few more years. His most recent hit was For the Weeknd, number 1 hit, that is. He's had spatterings of many, many top 10 hits and top 100 hits. Too many to count, basically. But his last one was with The Weeknd for Blinding Lights. And His history is pretty storied. Like, if you've listened to pop music at all in the last 20, 25 years, you have come across his songs, perhaps without even knowing it. He really got his start working at a Swedish production house, most famously with Ace of Base, for those people who can remember back to the early and mid-90s. But then, by the mid-late 90s, he, I'll say graduated, I'm not sure that's the right word, to acts such as Britney Spears, Backstreet Boys, and that whole late 90s pop music movement that then really took off the rest of his career. And from there, he's worked with, you know, Katy Perry, most notably, Taylor Swift, basically some of the biggest, you know, names in pop music. He famously does not give interviews in general, very rarely. He prefers to stay very closeted about everything. He's very much a name on a credit you see on an album, but will almost never, you know, be part of the marketing or you know, give, like I said, give interviews or talk to the press, talk to the media. The artists he works with credit him as being a musical genius. Like, there is great reverence for Max Martin. And there's a little bit of even a little bit of mysticism. There's been sort of this I'll call it a religion, but it's really not. It's something less than a religion of his, melodic math, right? The things he does to melodies and to songs to really perfect them and make them as catchy and, just as successful as they are. We're going to go over some of these things today. These are not the world's biggest secrets. These are skills and things that you can master in your own writing and production. And so I got two examples here queued up for you, and we're gonna explore what goes into a Max Martin song and why it sounds the way it does, and also kind of what makes it so universally good, right? At least to a general audience. Like, why do his songs get stuck in your head? What makes them, you know, easily to understand, immediately grokkable? What, you know, something that you can immediately grab onto and hang on to. And so, even if you've never heard him before, you certainly know his music, and I hope today we're going to go a level deeper and explore some of the techniques that he employs, you know, virtually across all of his projects, some of these things that are most universal. All right, so the first song we're going to look at, too, like I said, we'll look at Katy Perry's Roar and The Weeknd's Blinding Lights. Both were number one hits, though they are, you know, actually getting close to a decade apart. Not quite, a little under that. I have little sheet music transcriptions for both. You can see Max Martin's name is in the credits right there. First few things we should get out of the way. Max Martin does not use a lot of chords. He does not use a lot of fancy chords. His songs that he ever produces are pretty straightforward. Most have about 4 chords. Roar is almost exclusively 4 chords. There's a 5th chord that comes in basically just for a few beats right before the end. But everything else is, you know, this pattern of 4 chords, B flat, C minor, G minor, E flat. That's a cool chord progression. If you got a piano, you can, like I do, you can just bang it out. And I use different voicings in the Katy Perry songs that probably didn't evoke the feeling of the song yet, but still, you can hear the smoothness of that progression. Very simple chords. Also, very simple lyrics. English is not his first language. And so most of the songs that he's co-written or co-produced lyrics for also have pretty straightforward lyrics. And in the few interviews he has given, he's stressed how much of, when he writes lyrics, how much of it he cares about the sound of the words rather than the actual meaning of the words themselves. Basically, if it sounds good to his ear, if it sounds catchy, that's what he's going for. He is not trying to write Shakespeare. There is not any Robert Frost going on here. These are very accessible, you know, universal themes and words in terms of his lexicon. I did see a study that tried to put all his number one hits into a like a grade reading estimator, and I think on average it came out to about, be about a third grade reading level, just in terms of vocabulary and word usage. So real simple lyrics, real simple chords, you know, we're using the real building blocks. So what makes Max Martin great? Well, it's the stuff that goes on beyond that, right? How do we take simple building blocks and shape them to be the most beautiful, the most effective, the most naturally energetic and accelerating feelings? And so that's really the stuff we're going to look into today. And if you've never listened to music before, never thought about music, or never analyzed music in this way, this is going to be pretty revolutionary, I think. So, and Katy Perry's Roar, here, I'm going to play a little bit of it. YouTube, I'm going to get all sorts of copyright strikes if I put this on YouTube directly, so I don't know what's going to happen. We'll try. We'll throw it out there and see what YouTube does to me. Behead me at the guillotine of copyright law. But let's play a little bit just in case you just can't remember what the sound sounds like. Let's pause it there. So if you haven't heard that song before, I don't know, what are you, 6 years old? Like, have you lived? It was a huge song. Still, you know, still is in, I think, our public zeitgeist, certainly our musical pop culture. But this is such a great typical Max Martin song for so many reasons. The first of which is that Max Martin likes to build his songs very gradually. Like, he likes to add just little tiny tweaks, little bits of additional energy in each section. And the way that he does this primarily, at least from a core songwriting standpoint, is through the elevation of the melody. And here's what I mean. There's a great word we use, tessitura, in classical music to refer to a certain range of the singer's voice. We could use it here, but we don't have to use terms that are quite so fancy. Even if you don't read sheet music, I'm going to spell out some of these notes for you. We've got Fs, Ds, Cs, and B flats, and it kind of goes down. Those are the core notes of the verse, and it's descending. And it kind of lives there, right? Katy Perry is a great singer. Katy Perry has a great range. But this song, her verse is intentionally very constricted to these four notes. That's it. And it goes down twice. I used to buy my hung, hold my breath, worried about making my mess, right? And then, so I do quietly, agreed politely. These are almost like mirror reflections. There's a lot of symmetry, very simple, predictable sound bites in Max Martin songs. We're not trying to really throw the listener off. We're not really trying to surprise them. But instead, we're trying to give them things that they've already heard before. And we're going to come back to that concept. Max Martin really doesn't want to ever give the listener anything truly new. He's also said that, you know, a listener should be able to hear any 2 seconds of any song he's produced and know exactly what song it is, no matter where you put those 2 seconds in that listener's listening cue, right? If you, the end, the beginning, the middle, you hear 2 seconds, you know what song it is. And to some degree, we've already seen examples of that because of this repetitive chord progressions, right? The very limited chord vocabulary helps that. But in general, he also uses a very consistent sound palette with consistent instruments throughout and with very restricted note choice as well. All right, so we have this sort of four-note sing-songy melody. I'm also going to point out it always starts on the offbeat in this song in particular, but that's going to be that by itself isn't a Max Martin trait, but that's going to come back as a important thing he's going to play with later, because not only does Max Martin like symmetry, he also likes contrast, but he wants it to be contrast that you already have heard it before. And that's, I know I'm making a whole bunch of nonsense, give me a whole bout of tautologies and things that you can't really explain logically, but just follow along, it will. Okay, so we have this verse with these four notes. Great. And that keeps going. I forgot they have a choice. Which was a breaking point. Da, da, da. Same four notes. B flat, C, D, F, D, D, F. And but here we get to this new section. And everything we had before reacted to the downbeat, right? We had these big drums, this big right on this Katy Perry track, right? You have this big drum hit, and then the kitty bounces off it. Da 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 da. But here we get to what essentially is a pre-chorus, and you find these in Max Martin songs all the time. Max Martin doesn't usually just go verse, chorus, verse, chorus. He's not about juxtaposition. He wants this continuous flow build of energy. Perfect example of it here. Instead of bouncing off the beat, look how Katy Perry pushes the beat, right? You held me down, but I got up, right? She is the one driving the beat, but it's still not quite there yet, right? She is on the next line, right? She goes back to bouncing off of it. So we have a rhythm that's very similar to the rhythm we've heard in the verse. But getting into this pre-chorus, you know, her rhythm changes. Second thing, and this is even more dramatic, look at the pitch selection. No longer do we have B flat, C, D, F. We have D, F, and G. We have a brand new note. Very, just tweaking the pitch content just a little bit changes quite a bit from the beginning. It's such a small change, like musically, like again, we're not doing anything dramatic. We just changed, basically, we got rid of the C and the B flat in the bottom, we added a G on top. Like, we're just taking two notes away and then adding one higher. But that's all there is. That's the really subtle shaping of his melodic math that allows the energy just to naturally go up and escalate without it being dramatic, without big juxtapositions, with just these very subtle, like, pulls and tweaks. That happens again. Again, we're not about giving listeners new things. Once we have a new idea, or in this case, even literally a new note and with a slightly tweaked rhythm, we're not going to venture too far, right? We're just always dipping the toe in the waiting pool, in the lukewarm waiting pool. That is a Max Martin song. Okay, you hear my voice, you hear my sound, right? Bounce off the beat, boom. Like the thunder, they're going to shake the ground. You held me down, right? Do that all over again. We've already heard this before. This whole section, three notes. Katy Perry can sing way more than three damn notes. Like, actually, it's not true at all. We do get little phrases of the original phrase, the F, D, C, B flat. Again, things we've already heard before. But for the most part, all the new material, just three notes. Until we get to the bar right before the chorus or the hook. And something very special happens here. Because we start on F. We've heard plenty of Fs before. But we're going to drill that F. And then we go up to the G. Okay, G's our newest note. But then, finally, we have the tonic, in this case, B flat. Katy Perry is finally allowed to like leave that five note cluster behind, right? We had the original four plus the G. We have a new note right before the actual chorus hook section. And you might say, you know, hey, Dr. Nick, that's not a big deal. I'm saying, yes, it is in a Max Martin song. And this is, once you start to understand how his brain works and how he hears music and how he believes the rest of us hear music, these very subtle alterations of the scale make a big difference in terms of our subconscious and the impact that they have. Because this note is fresh. Like when Katy Perry goes up to the Eye of the Tiger, right, and she's belting it, it sounds awesome. It's like, I never knew I wanted this, right? It was the Christmas present you didn't know you wanted and you got. It was just perfect. Second point about this B flat, these pair of B flats. At this point in the song, there is no hesitation. There is no drum beat and Katy Perry bouncing off of it. Katy Perry is anticipating the downbeats, and she's actually tying notes over the downbeat, really for the first time. I got the Eye of the Tiger, right? Tie is over the downbeat. So the drums are reinforcing her. She is the one who's actually leading the beat. Everything else up here, especially in the verse section, she's backing away. Whenever there's a beat, she's not singing. Like, she lets the drum beat come into its thing. Boom. I used to bite my tongue and hold my breath. Boom. Scared to rock the boat and make a mess. Mm-mm. Not here. She's the one driving the song because she has the eye of the tiger or lion or whatever goddamn animal she wants to have. This part is so subconscious, right? This idea of the singer's relationship to the downbeat. But if you are following the meaning of the song, oh my God, it makes the song just click perfectly, just on such a natural, organic level. Like it's beautiful. And so when you start seeing these little, I know these are all really like kind of stupid, subtle things, like in isolation, you go, oh, it's just a happy accident. No, this is actually what Max Martin thinks about, right? Like how the singer relates to this downbeat, how the words get used, right, to further the meaning of the song. That's why the artists he worked with call him a genius. And so that's what he's listening for. That's what he cares about. I got the eye of the tiger, right? A fighter dancing through the fire. Look, super simple pitch content. F's in the bottom, G's and B flats. Three notes. We're just stuck with three notes. Katy Perry can sing way more than three goddamn notes for like the final time. This is like the middle of her range. These are the three easiest notes that she can sing. Like these are notes that just come out of her when she's pooping. Like this is not hard singing at all, but she's singing it loud, and the way it interacts with the beat and the way she's driving it. Look at all these ties over into the beat. When she sings fire, when she starts that F right before, that big drum beat comes in. And when she ends the word fire, boom, you hear that drum beat. Same thing here. When I, boom, I'm a champion. And finally, she sings a word on the beat. It's right during that hook. You're going to hear me roar. And during that final little hook, that little sauce on the end of the, what do you put sauce on? Ice cream? I don't know. It's chocolate syrup. There we go. You're going to hear me roar. We go above the B flat. Katy Perry's voice is finally allowed to fly just a little bit higher. How high? Not that high. C and D. We get two more notes right above it. So it's very controlled. Like there is no note out of place. There is no, you know, big florid passage. Everything is super calculated. Now, if we keep following this melody, how does Max Martin dissipate this energy, right? We took this melody, we sort of started down here, and we just bumped it up for the pre-chorus, then bumped it up again for the hook. That's fine, right? But now we have this new energy problem. We need to get back down to the verse. So how do we dissipate that range and have it come back down without it deflating, without the song losing momentum? Well, we have a little bit of a post-chorus. Again, Max Martin songs, we want very smooth, very continuous, you know, building and releasing of energy of this, you know, in this case, very directly the frequency contour in terms of how it's expressed. Okay. Look down here, louder than the lion, because I'm a champion, you're going to hear me roar, we do that again, and we get this, right, this, I think I played too many ahs, but I like them, so I wanted to play more, 2, 3, 4, 1, right, get that sound in your head. Now here's the thing, Max Martin doesn't want to ever surprise the listener. So how can he just do this, right? We have all this other melodic, you know, da 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 da, right? All this other stuff, and all of a sudden he just goes to just poking a note. Like that doesn't cover everywhere. That should be a total surprise to listener. Now, number one, those notes are really the same notes we heard in the hook, right? F, G, and B flat. We've already heard those three notes before, and that rhythm, you've already heard before too, except it wasn't in the voice. It was in the piano. It comes right out of that beginning. Except it's up here. When you start the song, that's what you hear. And that's what her voice is imitating at the moment. That top note is a B flat in both the piano and their voice, right? That oh. Listen to that beginning of that song again. It's right there in that piano. Da, 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 da. So he's very, very cautious about giving you a real contrast or any real moment of just pulling the carpet out from under you and putting you in a new place. He is not going to write Bohemian Rhapsody. He is not going to write Stairway to Heaven. He is not going to write these big epic songs with these giant dramatic changes. He's going to write these very tightly controlled machines that just take you from this energy level and just stretch you just a little bit and then bring you back down. And in doing so, he creates enough shape and enough momentum to make it consistent all the way through, right? So it's easily identifiable, but also give you just you know, a journey within that. Another nice little thing, since I just played that little sample, I'll point out, check this out. This whole chord progression is built on that B flat to C minor to G minor to E flat. And the pattern is always the same. 6 beats of the first chord, then 2 beats, then 6 plus 2. Whole song, 6 plus 2 plus 6 plus 2 plus 6 plus 2. Well, you could say that the intro section is a little bit different because it's a 6 plus 2, but it doesn't have a consequent, right? These are always grouped in 4. 6 2 plus 6 2. That's a set. Two sets, right? Or two patterns. 6 2, 6 2. Together those make 4 bars. But the 2 bars, the intro stand alone. So does he do a sped up version? Does he do like a 3-1, a 3-1 to just speed up that pattern? No. And in fact, he does something even more gentle to introduce your idea to that chord progression before you hear it, because it's actually really just B flat for 8. He just lets you sit and be comfortable on one chord. Except where there would normally be a C minor chord, he adds a C to the B flat chord. You get this little tiny dissonance. Now, just a little C. I'm still on B flat, but he's just adding a little bit of dissonance, even though I'm not changing the chord. And so that way, when you go into bars 3 and 4, which are really like real bars 1 and 2 of the verse, when we get to that C minor chord, all of a sudden when the harmony does change, your ear's already been prepped. It's already been trained to listen for a change on that beat. And in this case, the note he adds, and the first time to train your ear, is actually the entire chord he goes to in the next. Right? So that chord change isn't nearly as dramatic. And you can go back. It's these little tiny subtle things, right, that make him a master and so successful. And again, when these artists, you know, these naturally talented musicians and you know, hardest working people in the industry go work with him, and he gets really concise, he just cares about things that are beyond what they normally think about, right? If most artists do things a little more organically, a little more naturally, a little more what sounds good to their ear. And when Max Martin goes in and says, no, that note, that word needs to be on this beat, or you need to push forward here, or you need to pull it back, it kind of blows their minds, right? Because they're used to working with music organically, naturally, just doing what sounds good. And here's a guy who's sort of applying something like science to it. Let's look at another example. Let's go to Blinding Lights. And we'll play a little bit here. This is all intro here. Pause it here. Again, huge number one hit song. If you guys don't know it, you probably haven't heard of The Weeknd, but one of the sort of biggest crossover R&B artists working in pop music now. This song in particular has totally different sound palette, right? Where it's like we're right coming out of the 80s with those synthesizers, with those filter envelopes, right? Super 80s, you know, sawtooth wave synth sounds. Far more downbeat oriented, right, in terms of both the synth part and even the drum part too. I know the Katy Perry is super downbeat oriented, but this one is look at this boom chick boom chick boom chick boom chick in the drums. So just fast tempo, just playing every beat, but the melody, not the chords, but really the melody, whatever's playing on top of all that stuff, has a lot of syncopation in it. And so Max Martin's going to play a lot with the rhythm in this, and so we'll take a look and dig in that. Again, same. We're going to look at 4 chords, 4-chord song, right? The whole thing, 4 chords. And then they're nice chords. Like, I would totally use them. Super poppy. Yeah. Sweet. Yeah. Great chords. Melody, at least in this intro synth part, is kind of dumb. But it's got just a little bit of enough rhythmic interest to give you just a little bit of momentum. If I could actually play it. but after that, too, that it's just a little... It's four notes. It's really more like... I guess it is technically just... It's just straight up four notes. But when we get to the second half of that melody... We get that higher line here. And it's this moment in particular that's going to really haunt us, right? It's really going to sell the hook later on. So keep that little tune in the back of your mind. Okay, a few other things. Just going dipping back to the rhythm here. We have a very downbeat-oriented chord part, right? Look at like F minor chord. We're not playing off the beat. We're not waiting for the beat to come in. We see an F minor chord. We're going to play an F minor chord. We're going to put it right there on beat one, just like any intro to songwriter in a songwriting class totally would. We're not going to anticipate the beat. We're not going to push it back. Boom, F minor. But good. Put it on beat one. Great. Where does the next chord go? Well, it's going to go on the next strum beat, beat three. Nothing fancy. But towards the end, we get a little bit of a syncopation. We get that. We actually get this G, which is really sort of the accented note, but it's coming off the beat. Oh, okay. So we're gonna play with that downbeat just a little bit. We're not gonna always be right there. But again, right back to the downbeat, and then accent the offbeat. And when we get to the second half, we actually again have the highest note, the most climactic note on the downbeat, but everything's syncopated. Everything else is off the beat. And even the final F, actually it's B flat chord, comes in before the beat. So we have this pattern. I'm trying to get you to recognize in your ear of starting on the downbeat, and then we're gonna fall off the beat. When the singer comes in, when The Weeknd comes in, he's playing on a strong beat, but he's not on one, which is interesting, right? So he's like think of this more like a macro scale version of the synth part, where the synth part started on the downbeat and then kind of got on the offbeat. Well, he's still gonna basically start on the downbeat, just this is beat three. This is the second best downbeat, just to keep it a little bit interesting. Let's look at the notes and the melody. Really not that related directly, at least on your first pass, to the synth melody at all. Like, very contrasting. We get just two notes here, da 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 da, and then again the second time we go up to here. And so we have two notes in the first little phrase. We have four notes in the second phrase. They both start the same way. The biggest difference is how they end and how they climax. The first one doesn't have a climax. I've been trying to call, and it just doesn't have a climax to it. I've been on my own, right? We get up to this E flat. Oh, he pushes the pitch up for long enough, and then he dissipates the energy. Whenever we rise in pitch, we're usually increasing in intensity and energy, at least on a subconscious basis. Same thing again. We do the same melody. Maybe you can show me how to love, maybe. And so we get these four pitches with a slight hint of F right at the end. And it's funny because of those main four pitches, none of them are F. Where if you look at this chord progression, it's all F, right? F, F, E flat, F, G, C, E flat, F on the downbeat, F, right? We get all these Fs. And even during the hooky part, right, this... Right, we get that F right in the middle of the measure too. So, and we also resolve to F in that melody, right? So it's all F, 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 F. What are we going to do during the verse when the singer's actually singing? Well, he's not going to give you F. So we've sensitized your ears to F, and we're not going to give it to you. Finally, at the end of that, those four phrases, we do. But notice that F is not on the downbeat. It's on the offbeat. And so even though we're drilling all these Fs on downbeats, F, 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 when The Weeknd finally sings his first F, it's on the end of one. It's the G is the accent, right? He just sort of, it's almost like a throwaway. He's like, oh yeah, by the way, there's an F in there. I meant to sing F. He's too cool to actually sing F. If we keep going, second sort of phrase to this first verse, same exact pattern. We don't get to the F until the very end on the offbeat. And then we sort of get this, it feels like a chorus. I'm gonna call it a pre-chorus. If you were listening to the song for the first time, I think you're and you were just asked to label the section you're hearing now. I think you would say, oh, we're in the chorus now, right? It's the, you know, Sin City's cold and empty, right? No one cares, right? This little phrase. And this one has no downbeat, at least in the official vocal line. It's really about accenting the offbeats, right? This is technically a rest, right? We hit Sin City's cold. We get lots of syncopation, which is similar to the second half of that original synthesizer phrase, but it's all in the offbeat. So we're letting the music, you know, sort of pump on the downbeat, and then The Weeknd is taking off of that. So we have this contrast, right? That's not really anywhere else in the song until this point. We don't really have a point where the music, you know, hits and then the singer takes off. This is also a very different contour than almost everything else we have. Every other melodic shape we have is either just sort of noodle around a note in the synthesizer part, most notably F, or it's descending. Like, that's it. We can either sort of noodle like this, or we can fall down. We have a contrast. And so we have a rhythmic contrast. We have a contour contrast. All this part is going up. You can hear it, you know, rising. And this is really building to something. This is why it's actually not the chorus, because there's almost too much in flux, where we have sort of like too many new ideas a little bit, even though this idea is actually really just the idea of the synth line that turned upside down and on the wrong beat. So we're going to take that, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, sort of flip it around, flip it upside down, put it on, shift it over a beat, and you get this. If you just like don't think about it too hard, you can almost hear them as opposites, right? As like counterweights. This is a really interesting quirk. In the recording, there's a second vocal part that goes ah right on the downbeat to kind of hit. And my belief, I don't know this for a fact. I haven't you know seen any interviews or know any of the engineers who worked on it. My belief is that when they recorded it, this note was not intended, right? Max Martin really wanted to have a rest here. He wanted a contrast. He wanted to build with the same shapes, just flipped around and shifted. Again, they're all still sort of around your head. But someone, maybe it was even Max Martin himself, but someone was like, no, that feels too empty. Like we want to have, like all of this other stuff is so much downbeat, 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 downbeat. You're going to take away our downbeat from us? How dare you? Let's add another track. And so they got Abel or The Weeknd to, you know, just come in with, ah, just on the downbeat because it felt so naked. Okay, keep going here. Again, same shape. Once we have this shape, bum, ba-dum, bum, bum, ba-dum, bum, we're going to keep doing that, you know, over and over again. And then we have this very interesting non-chord part. That's what NC stands for in the sheet music, where we have our first D. All the notes we've had so far are really constricted. Again, similar to Katy Perry song, we're keeping the singer really hamstrung in a really narrow range. Again, The Weeknd has a great voice, great range. And if we look at the notes we're actually hearing from him, it is narrow. And this is very much a tenor part. Like, this is higher than what's my comfortable for my range. But, you know, we have a sixth, really, is really what we're covering for the verse. And the pre-chorus is worse. Like, we're technically a fifth. So in terms of musical distance, that's a sixth. There's the fifth. Altogether, we have one octave of distance covered. That's really narrow for a singer. Like, that's really not a lot of notes. There's no place to really show off. There's nothing explosive about it. It's super controlled. It's also universally able to be sung. And that's another key of course, of pop music, right? You want your listener to be able to have simple melodies that they can sing along with. Sometimes literally, and sometimes just in terms of their imagination, in terms of that earworm, that hook that will get stuck in their head later. But anyway, going back to this non-chord section, this is the first time we have a D. And so none of these notes that I've said, it's all pentatonic. But we have this great moment, you know, when you're, or ga, he sort of steps down, and just falling down, we get this brand new note that kind of catches your ear. This is actually quite shocking for a Max Martin song, just to drop out all the music and just introduce this new note. And again, I don't know the process for how they compose a song exactly. I kind of suspect it was they did have a chord at some point, but the D, you know, just was decided it was too dissonant or didn't work with it well enough. Like it was too like not sounding like everything else. So they just pulled the music out because they're like, well, the note doesn't fit the chord, or we don't have a chord in that simple chord progression that will fit. And so you get this great sort of solo moment for the voice just to sing a note that we have never heard before. And so that's pretty interesting, right? Just when we sing a brand new note, all the music has to go away. Like we just kill it off. Okay. After that, we have this vocal flourish that is so cool and is so good, but it's so easy to miss, right? Because he's just going to, I said, right? I said, I can't do the voice. I'm here. Let's play it. Let's have the weekend do it. I said. Right there. Did you hear that? I said. I did it again. I said. Right? I can't sing that. But again, he has a much higher tenor voice. This note that he does hit is a high B flat. Nowhere have we heard that in the vocal part, but guess what? That was totally what the synth jumped up to in the second line, right? So we have this kind of narrow noodling synth line, and we do that downward with that ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, right? That high B flat part, in this case, up here. That's the same thing that Abel sings in that I said. Huh, interesting. So even though this is kind of a shocking, like, totally new sound, we haven't heard anything like it before, we did in the synth part. Second, I said before, we really weren't letting the singer really focus too much on F during the verses. We get more of them during the pre-chorus, but the pre-chorus is all off the beat, right? The pre-chorus is all askew and it's going the wrong direction. The verses, we have that, you know, that sort of noodling and then downward fall, but we don't get any Fs. We don't get any, you know, strong Fs. So our ears are kind of missing it. And during the pre-chorus, you know, Max Martin and The Weeknd are sort of tickling our ear with more of it. But look what happens on that, the first note of the real chorus. Big fat downbeat high F. Just bam for over six beats. Just F. Again, go back and look at the beginning. F on the downbeat, 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 F on the downbeat. It's just F, 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 F. And for the most part, the singer's either avoiding it entirely or just tickling your ear with it until we get to the hook. And that's one of the reasons why this note is it works so well, is because you've been made to expect it from the synth part, from that intro. That verse part, we play with the fact that you didn't hear it. But now we're just giving it to you. This is the meat of the song. And again, we sort of get this sort of noodling, slightly downward kind of shape that's very reminiscent of the verses, just sort of transposed. But then, no, we get, I can't sleep until I feel your touch. Check out the melody the singer is singing. Heard that before? Yes, you have. It was just the synth line verbatim. And so Max Martin has already told you how the chorus of the song is going to be sung. How many bars? I don't know how many bars that is. 24 bars, 32 bars before we heard it. Like he's already told you. He's already programmed your ear to expect it, to like it. People like what's familiar. There's a reason why McDonald's is such a successful food chain. It's because they know exactly what they're going to get. It's not because it has the best food. It's because people know what they're going to get. And that's exactly the trick he's pulling here in this song. You give the listener this little synth line. You program them to listen to it and like it because it's familiar. Because, you know, it even gets repeated here twice, right? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. You take it away from them. And finally, when the singer comes and sings it, it's like, oh man, I've heard this song before. This is a good song. No, you haven't heard the song. You've just been programmed at the beginning of the song to listen to it correctly, right? To listen to it in a familiar way. And that's sort of the magic of how Max Martin composes these songs. He has said himself, he starts with the chorus, right? For almost all his songs, he writes this part first, right in here. And then he figures out a way how to get there. And so that involves working backward. And in this case, it's really easy to see how he got there. He literally took this and put it into a synthesizer at the beginning. Boom. Your ear is programmed. Get ready to listen to it. It's not, I can't say it's rocket science, right? But there is certainly an art and a craft to it. And just to reinforce it, after you've heard Abel sing it and you've heard the synthesizer play it, he finally kind of lets that energy die down again on an F, right? Where we resolve, of course, because we have to, because we've been programmed to like F so much. He lets the synthesizer do it again, just to reinforce the notion. Oh, yeah, yeah, I'm just playing the synthesizer part. Cool, you like that. You know that part, too. And all these parts reinforce each other and, you know, further that energy. These things are not hard, right? Like, anyone can write a song that you know, uses repetition, uses itself as a reference. But it's the way that Max Martin has been getting these singers to do it, right? He's been taking these singers and essentially getting them to adhere to his rules that has made these song forms so consistently successful. When you work with a producer, you know, some producers are really hands-off and just really want to make you, you know, express yourself. And I think Max Martin does a good deal of that. Like, he makes you think you're expressing yourself, but at the same time, the things he's tweaking, the things he's doing in all of his songs and all this music really are these very subconscious melodic principles about, you know, when I do this for this amount of time, then I have to stop doing it, right? If I'm always focused on the downbeat, then I need a section without being focused on the downbeat. If I have a section that's all about F, I need to have a section that gets away from F. If I have a section with, a big giant leap up in the melody, well, I need to get the listener used to hearing that. I need to preempt them. Again, these are not, you know, the secrets of the known universe. These are just principles that seem to be universal, at least in terms of, you know, Western music listening culture. So I hope you take some of these ideas from these videos, use them in your own productions, or use them in terms of how you listen to music differently. Or even if you just never heard of Max Martin before and you watch this video because you're like, oh, here's something I don't know and I want to learn about it, go check out the rest of Max Martin's songs and see if you can hear these other patterns in those productions as well. Or, you know, just keep listening to the radio. I'm sure he'll have another hit soon enough. So thanks for watching. Like, subscribe. I don't care. Do you.